On February 9th, coming up, which is about 2.5 weeks from now, is the very divine and very auspicious appearance of Sri Nityananda Ram. The Supreme Personality of Godhead, Lord Balaram, who's come again in this most magnificent and most, what we say, very merciful manifestation of Balaram, known as Nityananda. We have Gaur Nithai on the altar. Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadhar Sivasari Gaura Bhaktavind Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama Hare Hare. But before we can approach the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Radha and Krishna, we must approach them according to the teachings given to us in the Shastras. And the way to that, the way to Radha and Krishna is through the mercy of Gaur Nithai in this age. So there's a beautiful song. It's called Manushiksha, and it's written by Srila Narottam Das Thakur. And it describes the glories of Lord Nityananda. And I'll sing the first stanza, and then we can speak a little bit about each of the verses and what they mean. This is in glorification of Sri Nityananda. So those of you who know the song can sing along. Otherwise, just try to hear. Nittai pada kamalam koti chandra susitalhan Nittai pada kamalam Koti chandra susi Nittai pada kamala Koti chandra sushitala Jai jaya jaga juriha Jai jaya jaga juriha Hey no nitai bine ba Radha Krishna paiti nahi Hey no nitai bine ba Radha Krishna paiti nahi Vidya kori dhara nithai paan Vidya kori dhara nithai paan
So that was the first verse of four verses. And the translation is, the lotus feet of Lord Nityananda are the shelter where one will get the soothing moonlight, not only of one, but millions of moons. So the moon is very, what we say, necessary in our life. The cooling rays of the moonshine gives one a peace of mind. It also nourishes all vegetables within creation. The moon lights up the sky at night and is the most beautiful and, what we say, soothing of all the luminaries in the sky. But it is described here that one moon, how about millions of moons? So Lord Nityananda's lotus feet, the lotus feet of the Lord, Sri Balaram, come again as Sri Nityananda, is compared to
the soothing rays of millions of moons. Why do we need such, what we say, cooling effect? Just turn on the air conditioners, right? We can be cool. But no, it's not that type of cooling. The material energy is considered to be like a blazing fire. Samsara dava nanalita loka tanayakayuna guna gunatvam. Devagni, the word devagni, means fire, blazing fire, like a forest fire. So the material energy doesn't leave one for any peace. Constantly harassing the living entities with different types of miseries. Durga has her trident. You've seen Matiji Durga, right? She's got her... And there's three prongs there. Ariatmik, Aribhautik, Aridaivik. Klesha. Klesha means suffering. And so these three prongs represent the material energy and how it afflicts the living entity in this world. Miseries come by the body. Miseries come by the mind. We all know that. The body gives us trouble. The mind gives us trouble. As we get older, the body gives more trouble. When we're younger, the mind gives us mostly trouble. As we get older, the body gives us trouble. But even in old age, the mind will also bother us. So there's so many sufferings come by way of the mind and the body. Sufferings come by other living entities, Audi Baltic. What is those sufferings? Miseries caused by others. We can countlessly list how miseries come by other living beings. Just like you're sitting very peaceful and the mosquitoes come. You didn't invite them, but they're hungry and they see you as prasad. Right? So, and so therefore you have some difficulty and sometimes you can get very sick. In fact, now there's a problem with mosquito bites. It's actually causing great diseases in different areas of India now. So the mosquitoes, they'll come automatically, and the tax collectors, you work hard and they say, all right, pay. So you have to give them money, and they use it so they can get nice cars and, you know, have nice places to live. So different living entities, you know, enemies. Just the way the material energy is, that there's always disturbance by others. And that's called Audi Bhautik. And Audi Daivika, rain, excessive cold, excessive heat, various types of calamities, earthquakes, tornadoes, cyclones, miseries. So many things come by the devas and they afflict the living entity. So these are the miseries of the material energy that is already there. And then simply trying to fulfill our desires in this world is another struggle which brings more and more types of miseries, unwanted. So where is the relief? Where is the peace of mind? At the lotus feet of Sri Nityananda. So because the material energy is so, what we say, intense in its affliction of our existence, one moon is not enough. The soothing rays of one moon cannot soothe the suffering living entity. We need like millions, koti chandra, millions of moons. So Lord Nityananda's lotus feet are compared to millions of moons. And one should take shelter of those lotus feet. Unless one takes shelter of the lotus feet of the Lord Nityananda, there's no peace. No peace. Because who is he? He is Balaram come again. But who is Balaram? In the tattva of spiritual philosophy, Balaram represents that person who can give you shelter and give you transcendental knowledge. That knowledge which frees us from the suffering of material existence and raises our consciousness to the transcendental realm. So Brajendra Nandanaye Sachi Sutta Hoilo Se Balaram Hoilino Nitai. That same Brajendra Nandana Krishna from Vrindavan has again appeared as Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And that same Balaram has come again as Nitai. And in this incarnation, I mean, Krishna, what did he do with opposition? He killed it. He killed the demons. They were always coming into Vrindavan one after another and harassing the residents of Vrindavan. And Krishna dispatched them to the abode of Yamaraj one after another in a very playful and very quick way. But in this age, Prabhupada said, we can't kill the demons, because if you do, you have to kill everyone. He says, then everyone is afflicted with demoniac mentality. What does that mean? Demoniac mentality. Everyone wants to enjoy this material energy to the utmost extent, and therefore will cause so much difficulty for themselves and others. So how to get relief from this, what we say, struggle? And therefore, the lotus feet of Lord Nityananda gives that peace. It's like soothing rays of moon. Just like one moon, what can one moon do? Especially in Bombay. Have you seen the moon at night in Bombay? You can't even see it because it's full of, what is it, the cloud of the pollution? It covers the moon. So even this one moon is interrupted by the pollution of Bombay. So it has no real effect of giving a soothing, peaceful existence. Because we see in the history of people's existence, when a farmer, or what we say, a merchant would work hard, come home at the end of the day and he'd sit underneath the moon rays and feel some cool. Try that today. You can't even see the moon, what to speak of. Well, it's there, but its rays are somewhat ineffective. But that's material. Real soothing peace of mind comes when the heart is satisfied and takes shelter and frees themselves from all material suffering. That comes with the lotus feet of Lord Nityananda. So Lord Nityananda is very, very merciful. He is very, very kind. One cannot calculate the mercy of Lord Nityananda. His mercy is so freely given in the form of this process of devotional service. And then it goes on to say, unless one takes shelter under the shade of the lotus feet of Lord Nityananda, it will be very, very difficult to approach Radha and Krishna in Vrindavan. If one wants, this is the rest of the translation, if one wants to enter into the dancing party of Radha and Krishna, one must firmly, with great strength, grab hold of the lotus feet of Sri Nityananda. So Narottam Das Thakur is giving us that the ultimate goal is to approach Radha and Krishna and Sri Vrindavan Dham. That is the goal of this Krishna consciousness movement. That is the goal of life. To worship the Lord, to serve the Lord in the mood of Sri Vrindavan Dham. And Lord Nityananda is Lord Balaram come again. So he is Vrindavan. So only by his mercy can one approach Radha and Krishna. If one does not get the mercy of Lord Nityananda, as it says, it'll be very, very difficult to approach Radha and Krishna and Sri Vrindavan Dham. So one should pray for the lotus feet of Lord Nityananda. He is very kind. He is very merciful. How do we get the mercy of Lord Nityananda? Simply by following the process of devotional service, and especially chanting with enthusiasm and with great eagerness Krishna's holy name. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare. Ah, when Sri Nityananda sees one, oh, that person is chanting Hare Krishna. He must be a great personality. Let me give him my mercy. Let me bring him closer to the lotus feet of Radha and Krishna. So that is the mercy of Sri Nityananda. So now we'll sing the second verse. And this is the second verse of this prayer, Manashiksha. Sei sambandana hi ja Mrita janma kela thara Sei sambandana hi ja Mrita janma kela thara Sei pasu bara dura chara Nittai na boli lo mukhe Maji lo lo samsa sukhe Maji lo samsa Nittai na boli lo mukhe Maji lo samsa sukhe Vidya kule ki kori bethara Vidya kule ki kori bethara Anyone who has not established his relationship with Nityananda Prabhu is understood to have spoiled his valuable human life. Such a human being is actually an uncontrollable animal. Because he never uttered the holy name, because he never uttered the holy name of Nityananda, he has become merged in so-called material happiness. What can his useless education and family tradition do to help him? So Narottam Das Thakur says, connection. He wants to establish a connection. What is that connection with Nittai? How is that connection made? Through the process of devotional service. One who has not done that, it says that human life is meant for God realization. There is no second goal in this life. The human being, which is the evolved of all the species, at least on this planet, is meant to, according to Shastra, that human form of life is meant for God realization. Any other goals that one may receive should support the main goal, which is God realization. Maintaining family, becoming successful in one's occupation, and performing various types of duties to society, country, and family are all secondary and only valuable when they support the main goal, which is Krishna realization or God realization. So one who doesn't aspire for and ultimately attain God realization, now one who doesn't aspire for, we should say, has spoiled the human form of life. Hari Hari Vipale Jonama Gonainu Manusana Janan Vapaya Radha Krishna Nabadiya Janiya Sunya Pisai Kainu. So this human form of life, Narottam Das Thakur prays, I have wasted my human form of life. Why? Because I have not worshipped Radha and Krishna. I remember I was many years ago, way back, I think this was in 1996, more than 20 years ago, I was preaching in one country, Poland. And there was a translation going on because most of the people did not understand English. So the translation was also there. And I was just speaking the importance of practicing Krishna consciousness and giving general principles from based on the Bhagavad Gita. And in trying to encourage everyone to understand what is this human life and how to make it valuable and happy. So at the end of my lecture, I called for questions. And one man raised his hand, and he didn't speak at all any English. And he was very emotional, extremely emotional. In fact, he was so emotional, he was practically in tears. And he was not asking a question, he was expressing his heart. What was his heart? I didn't understand what he was saying, but I understand what he was trying to say. What he was saying, I could understand by his emotion, but not by the words. It was so strong. And later on, of course, right away, I asked the translator what he's saying. He said, "Oh, I am 45 years old. I wasted 45 years of my life. Oh, my life is so useless. I'm so miserable." And he was just lamenting that it's the first time he came in contact with Krishna consciousness. And he became inspired somehow by Krishna's mercy. And he was lamenting, "Oh, my whole life, 45 years, complete waste." So Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati gives a nice an understanding of what is valuable. Sometimes we think that the most valuable commodity is somehow some kind of what we say wealth or currency. But money you can get and you can also lose, but you can also regain it, right? It goes and it comes like that. But there's one thing that goes in one direction and doesn't return, and that is called time. Time. So Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati confirms what is the reality, that time is very precious. He doesn't say valuable, he says precious. It's the most precious thing. To use whatever time we have in this human form of life, and we don't know how much we have. We don't know, no one knows, especially in today's society where life... You were reading in the Srimad Bhagavatam this morning, you were hearing from the lecture from Govinda Prabhu, how that years ago it was very rare, back in the Vedic times, where a child would die before their parents. And if that did happen, then it was seen that the king of the country was not, what we say, up to the standard. He wasn't pious. There was something wrong with the ruling authority. And therefore, this would never happen unless there was some discretion in the rule. And so, but now, nowadays, you know, people die very young. Because this is the age of Kali. And so it's a very difficult age. And people are harassed by so many difficulties. So no one knows how long time will last in this particular body. So therefore one should see that every moment is valuable. It's the most valuable thing. And to use that moment, that time in the best way, means to come to God realization. Because God realization is the success of life. Only because we all want to fulfill our desires. But there's one way you can fulfill all your desires completely, perfectly, and eternally, and that is become God conscious. When you're God conscious, everything is there. Everything you're looking for, satisfaction, happiness, everything is there. Krishna provides everything you need simply by the fact that you have attained at least to the what we say a level of God consciousness where you don't look towards the material world anymore for anything. You find it all in your relationship with Krishna. So God consciousness is complete. So therefore, here, Narottam Das Thakur is explaining that one who hasn't come to the mercy of Lord Nityananda, they have spoiled their human life. And what does he say? He gives a very strong statement. He says that person is not an animal, but an uncontrolled animal. animals can be controlled, right? They can even tame tigers, lions, people even tame, and you see snakes also. Very poisonous, deadly snakes by mantra. Those who know can tame even the most envious of all creatures, the snakes. But a man who's uncontrolled can't tame him with anything. So he's therefore using that analogy, we understand that those who are determined to somehow or other try to enjoy this material energy, despite the fact that it's not possible, they become like an uncontrolled animal. Why? And then he goes on to explain, because they never utter the holy name of Sri Nityananda. They merge in so-called, what is called Maya Sukh. Sukh is happiness. Maya means that happiness which looks like happiness but is not happiness. Material energy presents itself to be a source of satisfaction, fulfillment of desires, and ultimately, what we say, peace of mind. But no one in this material world can actually be happy. Prabhupada, our spiritual master, was discussing this point. There's no happiness in this material world. And one devotee was saying, but Prabhupada, what about being in the mode of goodness? The mode of goodness is pious. The mode of goodness is religious. Prabhupada was saying, the mode of goodness, the most important principle of the mode of goodness is knowledge. And that knowledge teaches you there's no happiness here. So therefore, understanding the principle, why even material energy works in such a way is that if you want something and you don't get it, you're not happy. Or if you want something and you get it, it doesn't give you what you want and you're still not happy. Or if you want something and you get it and it gives you some happiness, but then it leaves you after some time. So you look at it from all three ways. You don't get it, you get it, or you keep it for a little while. Ultimately, it ends in suffering. So that's material energy, material maya. And while everyone's struggling to fulfill their desires, they're wasting their time and wasting all their energy when they can be using that to become God conscious. So maya, sukh, maya sukh, that happiness which appears to be happiness, but is not, it's something else. So that is, unless one worships the lotus feet of Lord Nityananda, one will remain chasing after something that is not catchable, which is an illusion. You can see material life, right? You can see it's right in front of you. Oh, there's something I can enjoy. There's something I can find satisfaction. But it's like grabbing smoke. You ever try to grab smoke? It's floating in the air. There it goes. Grab it. Where'd it go? You can see it, but when you try to catch it, there's nothing. So that's material happiness like that. And everyone is thinking that if I just, right, like the concept, the idea is, I'm not happy now, but I have plans. My plans will work in the future. In the future. But we say, trust no future, no matter how. So everyone is planning to be happy. Right? It's the plan of the happiness. And that goes on until there's no more time left. We're still planning. So that's material life. Always hoping, hope against hope. So, therefore, in this last part of the verse, what can one's, what we say, material education and family tradition do to help a person? They can't, they're like fallible soldiers. They cannot save one. They can't even save themselves, but to save others. Only the lotus feet of Lord Nityananda is the soothing rays that burns, that cools away the burning fire of material existence. So one should take, what we say, full shelter of the lotus feet of Lord Nityananda. So this is the second verse, and I'll Now we'll go on to the third verse. This is a beautiful, beautiful prayer. Narottam Das Thakur is singing. Ahankaram matta hoya nittai pada pasari ha ahankaram matta hoya. Ahankaram matta hoya nittai pada pasari ha. Asatye re satya kori mani. Nitaya koruna habe braje Radha Krishna babhe. Dharo nithai charana dukyani. Dharo nithai charana dukyani. Being maddened after false prestige and identification with the body, one is thinking, oh, what is Nityananda? What can he do for me? I don't care. The result that he is accepting something false to be truth. If you actually want to approach the association in Radha and Krishna, you must first achieve the mercy of Lord Nityananda. When he is merciful towards you, then you'll be able to approach Radha Krishna. Therefore, you should firmly grasp the lotus feet of Lord Nityananda. So here, Narottam Das Thakur says, one is maddened by false prestige or over-identification with the material body. One cannot understand, what is this Nityananda? Why should I even, what do I get from this? I'm just, is this some idea only? Is it actually... False prestige means somehow or other I've achieved something in this material. I have some position. I have some wealth. I have some satisfaction. Therefore, why should I even bother with Lord Nityananda? What are they doing? They're accepting the illusion as reality and accept the reality as simply another form of imagination. And therefore, they can never make any progress in life. Always frustrated and always in anxiety, trying to get more and never satisfied by what they get. Therefore, they'll never be able to approach the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Radha and Krishna in Vrindavan. Lord Nityananda is so merciful. Not only is he sending out his representatives to speak on his behalf, he is personally going out. Bodhisuke Kabogai, Bodhisuke Kabogai. He sets up a marketplace, and he is the proprietor of the marketplace, and he has a product. He's a merchant. He's only got one product, and it's expensive. You have to have a lot of rupees, to buy this. He set it up, and he puts his representatives, and he says, okay, now, if you have some faith, you can buy the product. So give me some rupees. No, he doesn't say that. He's asking, what is he asking? He's asking for our faith. And what is the product? The chanting of the holy names of the Lord. So Lord Nityananda, he goes from town to town, village to village, from place to place, just canvassing on behalf of Radha and Krishna and Vrindavan. And he's saying, chant the holy names of the Lord.
chant, chant, chant. Can't. No time. Too busy. Got so many things to do. Got places to go. Got people to meet. And I'm tired, so I have to take a rest. So, no time. Right? Prabhupada was in he was in Delhi. This was before he came to the United States of America to begin his mission. Prabhupada put together a little one sheet paper called Back to Godhead magazine. And in that one paper, he would go, he would write the article, he would take the article to the printer, and he would arrange for the printer to print it up, and then he would collect the results, and then he would take it in his own hands all alone, and he would go to the tea stalls in Delhi and saying, here, this will help you. This is knowledge about eternal life. This is about your devotion to the Lord. And they would say, oh, Swamiji, you are so nice. What you're doing is very good, but we have no time. We have no time. And everywhere Prabhupada would go, he would hear, no time. So the next publication, he titled, No Time. People have time for everything but Krishna. No time, no time, no time. And so, yeah, but then when time runs out, then what do you do? Then it's too late. Some people say, yes, life is meant to go for it, become successful, have a big family, get a lot of material things and do a lot of things. And then, you know, when you get old and you get, and then you can chant Hare Krishna, right? Right, that's good philosophy. But there's an analogy. There's like, there's a man, he's sitting on the side of the road and he's got his little shop. And he's selling grains, some grains of rice, and maybe other grains also. And then all of a sudden, a big wind comes and takes his grains up in the sky, and he says, my dear lords, please accept my offering. You can't offer it when you don't have it. It's gone. He's already, he's losing it, so he thinks, while I'm losing it, I'll offer it. So, therefore, we have to use now the time. It's when it's towards the end of life, and you want to offer it at that time, Krishna said, oh, what did you do before that? So, yeah, so we can't fool and just think, oh, now I'll be so materially successful and after that I'll be Krishna conscious. No guarantee like that. So Lord Nityananda is very merciful. He goes everywhere, to every town and every village. We see in the world now this ISKCON society started by His Divine Grace Srila Prabhupada and based on the teachings of Bhagavad Gita and Srimad Bhagavatam about the worship of Radha and Krishna and Sri Vrindavan Dham. Since then, every country practically in the world and practically every country has translated Bhagavad Gita into the local language. There are over 100 different languages now that Bhagavad Gita is translated into. Places like China, and place in countries in Africa and very remote countries in the South Pacific and in very remote parts of the world. Preaching is going on. Lord Nityananda and Lord Chaitanya, especially Lord Nityananda, he is going everywhere. Lord Chaitanya told Lord Nityananda when they were in Navadvip, you take your good associate Srila Haridas Thakur and you go. And you go to every house, you knock on the door, and you and tell everyone to chant Hare Krishna. So Nityananda, he took that message on his head, and along with Haridas Thakur, they would knock on people's door. Oh, Nitai, please come. Yes, how can we serve you? Oh, yes, here's some refreshments. No, I didn't come to get your refreshments. please chant Hare Krishna.
Oh.
We have no time. We have our families to take care of. We have the children. They need education. So many things. So what he would do, he would take a straw in his mouth, because we know that when you take a straw in your mouth and you fold your hands like this, it is the supreme expression of humility and supplication. So he was begging them, please chant Hare Krishna. And then he would roll on the ground. And they would say, okay, nitai, 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 get up, get up, get up. We'll chant, we'll chant, we'll chant, we'll chant. So he would go to the extremes, just begging them simply to give them what they need. He has something to give, not something to take. He's coming to give. So every day he would go. And then they would come back in the evening to Lord Chaitanya and report their Sankirtan scores. How many people did they actually convert to chant Hare Krishna? Lord Chaitanya would be happy. Now Lord Nityananda was thinking, you know, we're going, and we're going to mostly people who are very pious. But we want to find someone who is not at all pious, who is a rogue, who is the lowest, who's a dacoit, who is the most sinful. If I can give the mercy of Lord Chaitanya to that person, then how glorious will Lord Chaitanya be? So they were looking. And then they asked the townspeople, is there such people around? Oh, you're talking about Jagai and Madai. They are very sinful. Nobody goes near them. They're always drunk, always fighting amongst themselves, and anybody who comes near them, they punch them. And they always, and then when they're not drunk, they're always doing other nasty things, like chasing after women and burning people's houses down and stealing things. They are always sinful. We don't go, we're afraid of them. They're actually the sheriff. Nityananda said, thank you. Perfect person to give Lord Chaitanya's mercy. So they went, and they could see, oh, they're very intoxicated. So Nittai said, hey, you two brothers, who's calling us? Who are you? I'm Nittai. Who's Nittai? Oh, I've come to give you something. You can't give us anything. And so he said, I've come to give you the mercy of Lord Chaitanya. Please chant the holy names of the Lord. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare. What is this chanting? Madai, let's get him. So they start running. And Nityananda, and he ran. And then Haridas Thakur was running. So they were running, and of course, Jagai and Madai were kind of slow because they were drunk. And Madai, he was fat. He couldn't run too fast at all. So they were running and running, and Nityananda was laughing. And Haridas Thakur said, you know, Nittai, I was beaten in 22 marketplaces and somehow I got away, but now with associating with you, I don't know what my future is. And then they started to laugh. And then that night they came and they reported their Sankirtan scores we were successful, but except for these Jagais and Madai. Oh, Sri Advaita was there. And Haridas Thakur said, you know, he goes. He doesn't have any discrimination, this Nittai. He doesn't make any, he goes to the most dangerous old people. These people are drunk, and when someone's drunk, you don't know what they're going to do or what they're going to say. Okay. But Advaitacharya said, Well, Nityananda, he's a drunkard also. So drunkards, they like to associate with other drunkards. He's drunk on the holy name of the Lord. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. So
So they started to laugh. And then Nityananda was thinking, tomorrow I will go again and I will be successful. So again, the next day, the first thing in the morning, they headed out. There they were, the two persons, same spot, laying on the ground. Their clay pots broken, the wine falling all out. They're all drunk. And they saw Haridas Thakur and Nityananda again. You two guys are back again. Don't you understand? We don't want you. So Madai got very angry and picked up a pot which was broken and threw it at Lord Nityananda and hit him in the head. And when he hit him in the head, it caused Lord Nityananda's head to bleed. Oh, when the townspeople were all watching, they ran back to Lord Chaitanya to tell him what was happening. Nitai's been injured. Oh, Lord Chaitanya immediately came. He saw, he came to the spot immediately. He could understand what was happening. He took out his chakra and he was about to kill both of them. He was like Yamaraj at the time. And so, but Jagai grabs the feet of Lord Chaitanya, says, please be merciful to us. We didn't meet it. In fact, it wasn't my fault. It was his fault. He did it. So, you know, they're together, but when they get in trouble, they always blame the other guy. So, yeah, so Lord Chaitanya somehow was pacified. And Nityananda also said, my dear Lord, we in this incarnation, we are not like in our previous incarnations where we killed all the demons. We have to kill the demons by killing their mentality, destroy their mentality by giving them the mercy of the holy name. So please spare these two very fallen persons. When Lord Chaitanya heard the plea of Lord Nityananda, and of course Jagai was also praying, he became somewhat peaceful. But then he said to Jagai, Jagai, Nityananda has been injured, so unless you two get his mercy, you cannot get my mercy. So Madai, seeing what was happening, he ran to the lotus feet of Lord Nityananda and he begged forgiveness, praying to Lord Nityananda, please forgive me. I didn't realize who you were. I didn't realize what you were trying to give us. And like a mother, sometimes when she tries to take care of the child doesn't appreciate the care of the mother, may even kick the mother, and may even try to do something to harm the mother, not understanding that the mother's care is for the child's benefit. So Nityananda was in that mood, not caring that he was injured. He simply forgave them, and he was so happy that they had somehow become a little humble. And now praying to Lord Nityananda for forgiveness, he said, of course I forgive you. Now, and Lord Chaitanya, when he saw that Lord Nityananda had forgiven him, something miraculously happened. This was a really amazing miracle. All the sinful activities that Jagai and Madai, and Jagai and Madai had committed so many sinful activities in the boat of Yamaraj. Yamaraj is there and he's talking to his secretary Chandragupta, and he says, my dear Chandragupta, can you give me a count of the sinful activities of Jagai and Madai? He says, my dear Lord, it's not possible. We have arranged for 30 new scribes to write down their sinful activities. They are working 24 hours a day. They're exhausted and they cannot keep up. So I cannot give you an account. It's impossible. So the sinful activities in Jagai and Madai were so numerous that they were uncountable. But Lord Nityananda immediately, and what happened? After they received the mercy of Nityananda, all the sinful activities, the reactions of those activities, left their bodies and merged into the body of Lord Chaitanya. Lord Chaitanya's beautiful golden body became blackish. And Advaitacharya was there. He said, oh, my dear Lord, you look like Krishna. But actually, it was the sins of Jagai and Madai that entered into the body of Lord Chaitanya. And Lord Chaitanya said, now you are both free from these sinful reactions. Well, where will these sinful reactions go? They must go someplace. They will go to anybody who commits offenses against Vaishnavas. Anyone who offends the Vaishnavas, they will get some of the reactions of the sinful activities of Jagai and Madai. Lord Chaitanya made that declaration. So now, freed from their sinful activities and purified, they prayed to the Lord, please give me some seva. And Lord Nityananda instructed them, you go down to the banks of the Ganga, and there you make a ghat. And then that ghat will be very special. All the pilgrims will take bath in your ghat first before they actually go into the Ganga. And he did that. And while he was building the ghat, people came and said, oh, there's that mud eye. He's such a rascal. And they used to they would pick up a rock and throw it and hit him. Now he was completely changed. His heart was completely pure and he had received the full mercy of the Lord. So when he would get hit with the rock, he would take the rock, pick it up and bring it back to the person and throw it and say, please throw it again. That's how much he changed. His heart became so soft and his mind became so free from any negativity, any bad feelings towards anyone. That's the mercy of Nityananda. So we pray for that mercy. Nittai Pada Kamalam Koti Chandra. It is like thousands, millions of soothing rays. So Narottam Das Thakur prays that yes, without the mercy of Lord Nityananda, there is no mercy available. So we'll end the song with this last verse. So Narottam Das Thakur, in his great glorification of Lord Nityananda, now speaks about himself. Nittaye charana satya tahera sevaka nitya. Nittaye charana satya tahera sevaka nitya. Nittai pada sadakuru asahan. Narottamo goro dukhe nittai moro goro sukhi. Narottamo goro dukhi nittai moro goro sukhi. Rako ranga charanara pasaha. Rako ranga charanara pasaha. The lotus feet of Nityananda are not an illusion. They are a fact. One who engages in the transcendental loving service of Nityananda is also transcendental. Always try to catch the lotus feet of Lord Nityananda. Thus, this Narottam Das Thakur is very unhappy. Narottamo Bodo Dukhi. Therefore, I am praying to Lord Nityananda to make me happy. Nittai Moro Korosuki. My dear Lord, please keep me close to your lotus feet. So Narottam Das Thakur ends this beautiful glorification of Lord Nityananda, explaining, some people might think that the lotus feet of Lord Nityananda are some imagination, some illusion, but actually they are real, they are tangible, they are available. Simply by remembering the lotus feet of Lord Nityananda in devotion, one finds shelter there. One who engages in the transcendental loving service of Lord Nityananda is also transcendental. Lord Nityananda, Lord Chaitanya have come simply to give the holy name to the entire world. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Sometimes you might think, why should I chant? I have so many things to do. What am I going to get benefit? And anyway, I did chant. But one should think, oh, Lord Nityananda is so merciful. If I chant, he will be happy. Someone asked me a question the other day. Interesting question. It says in the Bhagavad Gita, Manmana bhava bhat bhakto mam yaji mam namaskuru. Krishna says, always think of me, become my devotee, worship me, and offer your homage to me. Homage means you pay obeisances to the Lord. And so one devotee asks, well, what does God get when I pay my obeisances to him? What does he get? I know what I get, but what does he get? So is he calculating? And I said, well, he's pleased. He becomes satisfied. You're doing what you're supposed to do. Just like the mother, when she sees the child obeying her, she becomes happy. It's for the child's benefit she acts, and at the same time, she's pleased when the child does the right thing for themselves. So when we serve the Lord becomes pleased. He becomes happy. So when you make the Lord happy by what you do, you also become happy. Sometimes devotees would ask Prabhupada, how do I know Krishna's happy? How do I know? Prabhupada said, when you engage in devotional service, if you feel happy, that means Krishna is happy. He's happy because he's giving you that happiness in a small form in your own heart, by your own devotional service. So, by chanting the holy names, we make the Lord happy. And if you want to love someone, you want to show your love someone, what do? You do something to make them happy, right? Love means to make the person you love happy, or to do something that is pleasing to them, that is satisfying to them. So the Lord becomes satisfied when we chant his holy name. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. So Narottam Das Thakur, in this last verse, he's speaking from our position. He's happy. He's a Mahasayi. He is a pure devotee of the Lord. Narottam Das Thakur is a great soul. He came on the instructions of Lord Chaitanya to keep Lord Chaitanya's teaching alive after Lord Chaitanya disappeared. He had a mission. But he's saying, I'm unhappy. Is he unhappy? No. Why? He's saying that. Why is he saying that? Because he's representing us. He's taking the position of us. We are unhappy. Why? We need that the lotus feet of the Lord. So therefore, my dear Lord, make me happy, give me shelter at your lotus feet. The Lord is offering his lotus feet, but then he's not assuming that, oh, I can just get it because I want it. Give it to me. He's praying for it. If something is available, but at the same time you want to appreciate and show your, love for the person who gives it, you say, can I have it? Please give it to me. Like that. So there's a type of
You're giving, but still I'm asking. You're giving, but still I'm asking. Because I'm showing you I really want it. When you ask, that means you want it, like that. Sometimes somebody will give you something, and you may not want it, or you may not need it. You may just accept it because they give it to you. But when you want something, and you know that person can give it, and wants to give it, you ask for it, then the exchange is perfect. So he's saying, oh, please give me the shelter of the lotus. Keep me close to your lotus feet. So this is our position. We are wandering in this material world, and we're looking for that shelter, which is perfecting. The lotus feet of Lord Nityananda is the perfect place to find that shelter where all peace and happiness and devotion can be found. And from there, Lord Nityananda takes us to Lord Chaitanya. Lord Chaitanya takes us to Sri Vrindavan Dham. So by the mercy of Lord Nityananda, we can accelerate our process to Sri Vrindavan Dham with a loving service, as it says in the first verse, to enter into the dancing party of Radha and Krishna in Sri Vrindavan Dham. So that is the goal of this Krishna consciousness movement. So thank you very much. This is a beautiful song, Nitai Pada Kamalang, Teachings to the Mind. Hare Krishna. Is there any questions or comments? There's a question right there.
Mm-hmm. Hare Krishna. Mm-hmm. Hare Krishna Maharaj. It is said that by the mercy of the Lord, one gets association of the saintly personality, and by the mercy of saintly personalities, one attains the Supreme Lord. So if we look one step backward, what is that state of mind which attracts the first drop of the mercy of the Lord?
That's mentioned in a Nectar Devotion. What is that? It's called causeless. Somehow, something in our life became auspicious. And because of that auspiciousness, we came in contact with a devotee. The wisdom is called causeless mercy. That mercy that it cannot is without a cause, but has a cause. It's without a cause because there's nothing we did to earn it. But there's something in our existence that we did that the Lord somehow was pleased, and by His plea, He somehow directed us towards the association of devotees. It may have happened in a previous lifetime, or maybe even 10 lifetimes ago. But there was something that was there. But Lord Nityananda and Lord Chaitanya, we see even they gave the mercy to people who were completely unqualified, Jagai and Madai. So they are going beyond the scriptures and just giving the mercy to everyone and anyone. Prabhupada uses the example. If someone comes up to you and says, here's 100 rupees. Yeah, I want to give you a donation. And you say, well, you're a nice man, thank you very much, but you keep it, No, it's okay, thank you. No, he says, no, you take it. You say, no. So then he takes it and pushes it in your pocket. He puts it in your pocket for you. And he says, now you keep it. So that's Nityananda. The Lord is giving the mercy, even though we are not qualified. And what is that mercy? The association of the saintly persons, which gives us the association of the Lord. And by the association of the Lord, we can appreciate and take more advantage of the association of the saintly persons.
Is it something from the side of the living entity, like after many previous lifetimes and present lifetime also, the suffering comes every time. So due to this suffering, on and on, one may start thinking that, oh my God, I'm tired of this. Yeah. Is there a way out from here?
Yeah.
That is the point where the Lord showers His mercy?
That's one of the reasons why one may come to Krishna consciousness, yeah. Because one is questioning, why do I have to suffer? How can I get out of this suffering? So the answer comes in different ways. One may start to look, oh, maybe through my worship of the Lord I can find relief from my suffering. So when one thinks like that, and Krishna says that in the Bhagavad Gita, that four types of people come to me, and one who is suffering doing the material existence like that. So that's one of the reasons, yeah. But there may be others. There may be other reasons. But especially in Kali Yuga, suffering is the main product here. And believe me, I don't want to sound like a doomsday prophet, but the world's going to get worse. There's two things that are happening. Spirituality is increasing, and demoniac activities are also increasing. Both of them are happening at the same time. More people are taking to spiritual life, and more people are being consumed by this horrible soul-killing society. And so the middle of the road is becoming less, and the two extremes are becoming more. So, therefore, it's almost, as Prabhupada said, one will understand that there's no way that one can find any happiness in this world unless they come to Krishna consciousness. Because there's no piety left. I mean, people could find some kind of relief in material life if they were pious, at least for some part of their life. But people are impious now. Everything is impious, right? There's no piety left. The movies, the entertainment, the activities, everything. Business means make as much money as you can. Doesn't matter how much you have to exploit other people, just get money. Mm-hmm. So this is a time, Kali Yuga, where people are harassed from all angles. And so therefore, Krishna consciousness becomes that shelter, even from freedom from material suffering. Yeah. Yeah. Anything else? Any other? Yes, behind, in the back there. The gentleman with the orange shirt there.
Hare Krishna. Thank you for wonderful lecture, Maharaj. Sunday we come to temple and we feel very good, but remaining day it's very difficult to control our mind. And though we do all 16 round of japa and reading lot of things, but it's very difficult to control the mind. So please guide us how to control mind.
I'm trying to figure that one out too. Controlling the mind. Krishna said to Arjuna said to Krishna, he said in Bhagavad Gita, what is that? Chanchala himana Krishna pramiti balava dirha tasyaham migumam maye vayaridam saduskaram. Krishna, you're asking me to control the mind, but I think you're asking me to control the wind. The mind is restless, turbulent, unsteady. And so therefore, it's very difficult to control the mind. I think it's easier to control the wind. And Krishna answers in the next verse, Abhyasena tu kuntaya vairagyana chagrihate. Yes, you're right, Arjuna, but it can be by constant practice and detachment from sense gratification. So by giving up those activities that agitate the mind and senses, sense gratification, and practicing the process of chanting the holy names, gradually the restless mind will gradually become more and more controlled. So it's like trying to control a wild animal. The mind is really restless. So even Arjuna, not to speak in this age, where the mind is being distracted by so many things in this age that you don't even need, right? Billboards and hoardings and TV, this, that, and everything. So many bombardments on the mind. So we have to just detach ourselves from all this and focus on chanting the holy names. So you practice. Practice, practice, practice. I can't say there's an instant formula, it takes practice. And Krishna says, you have to practice it, that's all.
Hare Krishna Maharaj, may I ask you two questions simultaneously?
Yes. I'll okay. Answer them separately, not simultaneously.
Okay. My first question is, as you said, that spiritual activities are also increasing side by side, demoniac activities are also increasing. From a mathematical perspective, can you give us the ratio regarding that? And ratio. My second ratio. And second, my second question is that when we are trying to give Krishna, when we are trying to give the people Harinam, we may come across some people who may speak to us rudely or rashly. So how to deal with them, such people?
Your ratio is hard to figure out, but you see, the Shastras say that in this particular Kali Yuga, Lord Chaitanya has appeared. He doesn't come in the other 999 Kali Yugas. So this Kali Yuga is very special because Mahaprabhu has appeared. And Kali, the personification of sin, knows that Lord Chaitanya is here, and he's afraid of Lord Chaitanya. He's worried. So he's moving fast. So he's moving as fast as he can, trying to capture as many people into the sinful activities as possible. Even in the name of religion, people are committing sinful activities. So Kali is working fast, but Lord Chaitanya also has his army. So it's two armies trying to capture as much souls as possible. Kali and Lord Chaitanya. So, Prabhupada said, he told us, he said that we can make the whole world Krishna conscious in 18 days, but he said to us, you're not pure enough. So as the devotees become more and more pure, then the faster Krishna consciousness spreads like that. So, Lord Chaitanya is encouraging us to become more and more fixed in our Krishna consciousness. Then we can be his mercy instrument for giving Krishna consciousness to the other. But Kali's moving fast. He's moving fast. You can see it. The latest elections in the United States of America just shows how fast Kali is moving. Moving fast. I don't know if you're watching the news, but it's crazy now. Half the country is divided against the president. There's mass demonstrations in the United States now. Millions of people are taking to the streets. And he's not even president yet. So the whole country is up in arms now. They're all divided against this up-and-coming president, you know. Mass protests, and even the protests are becoming violent. So what does that mean? That means that more and more violence, more and more control by state authorities. When people rebel, then states become more repressive. And then there's more and more less liberties. So then what you have is more and more fascism, more and more strictures, and people's liberties are destroyed because of what we say, social and political unrest. So it's happening all over the world now. And that's just one indication. But that's not the problem. The problem is not political unrest. The problem is a lack of spiritual life. When people take to material life and no longer worship the Lord, but are interested only in sense gratification, then they lose the mercy of the Lord and have to suffer. And when that happens, everything breaks down. The entire system breaks down. Politics, sociology, anything of the social, political, and ecological problems are simply extensions of the real problem, lack of spiritual life. That's all. And people become more irreligious and more atheistic, and you have more social, political, and ecological problems. That's all. So, therefore, the solution is Krishna consciousness. Spread Krishna consciousness and people will change. And the world will also change. And what's the second thing? When you try to give Krishna consciousness to others, people become rude or that they don't really want it. Well, it's explained that you should not throw pearls to swines. In other words, if people don't want it, don't force it. You see, Krishna consciousness is voluntarily. We don't try to force people. We encourage them in different ways and try to give them a book or some encouragement, come to the temple or something like that. But if people don't want it, we just graciously say, thank you very much. Here, take a little prasadam. So, if you become disturbed, then everything is lost. So you just tolerate it, and if you can offer some prasadam, that's fine. But don't force it. We can't force people. It's not about force. Love cannot be forced. Love can only be encouraged. And so we use different means for encouragement, but ultimately it's up to them. Sometimes if you behave very properly and nicely and respectfully, even though they're rude, they appreciate you. And then sometimes later they also become what we say, Krishna conscious. There's a story where one girl, she was distributing books in some place in Europe, I think it was in Italy, and when the trains would stop at the train station, she would get on the trains and then try to distribute books, and then she would be on there for 5 minutes, and then when the trains began, she would come off. And so this happened, and one time one man was on the train. And so he was disturbed by her, and she offered him a book, and he got very nasty. He took her and pushed her out the door, and she fell onto the dock. And then he was very disturbed because of her, and he pushed her and hurt her. And then he later on, but somehow or other, she left the book on the train. So he picked it up and just kept the book. And he went home, took the book and put it in his library. Many years later, he got cancer and he was dying. So he's looking for some relief. So he went through his library looking for the Bible. He was somewhat of a Christian. Couldn't find the Bible, but he found the Bhagavad Gita, the same book that girl gave him. And then he started to read the Bhagavad Gita. And he started to find some happiness, some satisfaction, some peace of mind. And his whole consciousness changed. And then he was remembering the girl, and he felt so sorry. And then he went to the temple. He knocked on the door. When they opened the door of the temple, there was nobody there. And then they looked. He was on the ground. He was paying his full obeisances. He was crying. He was sorry that he had what we say, hurt that girl, and he was wanting to come and apologize, and he wanted to somehow learn more about Krishna consciousness. So she was very polite, she didn't force it, and he somehow or other was able to get the mercy by Krishna's arrangement, like that. So you never know how things are going to work out. So don't try to force it, just try to encourage it in the best you can, like that. If people are rude, what can you do? Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. Srila Prabhupada
Ki Jai. His Holiness Chandramani Swami Maharaj Ki Jai. Request the devotees.